there's always been a sort of circularity in my writing and in my journeys with books and writers. And all the things I do have somehow fed into each other, nurtured each other, supported each other. And I've been really, really fortunate in that. Many people have a day job which clashes with their inner passion. But each of the things I do give me so much, so much, that I have no words to describe my gratitude. Let me begin in the beginning. When I was all of 26, I wrote this book. It's called Paro, Dreams of Passion, and that's the very first cover of the very first edition, which was published by Chatto and Windus in London in 1984. And this book gave me a sort of instant notoriety, I became notorious. And I became notorious because middle-class Indian women were not supposed to write books that were so sexy and so funny. So I began on the, you could say, the wrong note. And as a result, the next book I wrote, which I don't have here, was a book called A Himalayan Love Story. And it was so depressing, that nobody wanted to buy it. And I wrote it just to show that actually I'm a serious writer. And it was in fact published many years later as part of my Himalayan trilogy, and it is one of my favorite books. And here is Paro. I came back to Paro 25 years after it was first published in this wonderful double bill, which goes this way and that way. It's a flip-flop edition. And I took the characters in Paro back in time when it was written and then fast forward to 25 years later. And this was for me an exercise in the craft of writing, because when you first begin writing, you have beginner's luck, and it's easy because you don't know the rules, so you can break them. And as you grow older and more cautious, even if not wiser, then you have to return to the craft at a different rate, on a different basis, with a different relationship with the words. So after the Himalayan love story and another book called God's Graves and Grandmother, which got written actually when I had cancer, and I don't have a copy of the book here with me, but when I wrote this book, I wrote it out of desperation, getting out of hospital and knowing I had to do one more book before I died, if I was to suddenly die. And it took in all the things that were in my line of vision at that time. Outside the house where I was healing, there was an old tree next to it. Some laborers had put three stones and a temple was building up there. That became the basis of that story. What I'm trying to explain to you here is that each writer picks up the tools available, the stories available, the narratives about around them, and takes them as the base of the story. Many, many books later, in 1998, I embarked on a project which was very, very precious to me and proved invaluable in the years to come. This was a set of oral biographies, and it is called Mountain Echoes, Reminiscences of Kumaoni Women. Was the oral biographies of these four older women, my aunts, my grandmother, and the stories of their lives and the lives of their mothers before them. And this is an invaluable genealogy. It is an invaluable research which came so naturally and so spontaneously and was offered as a gift to me by these very modern, very before their times, very liberal, very traditional women. So I'm going to read out the last bit of that for you. It says, the history of women is left to us in folklore and tradition, in faintly remembered lullabies and the half-forgotten touch of a grandmother's hand, in recipes, ancestral jewelry, and cautionary tales about the limits of a woman's empowerment. The life of a woman is an interior life. It is spent in daily tasks. It follows the rhythm of the seasons, and usually it ends and passes without record. And this has been a very important part of my writing after that. So this book, Mountain Echoes, Reminiscences of Kumaoni Women, led to so many circularities, so many expansions of the narrative within it. It was to become the title of one of the best loved literature festivals I have ever done, which was the Bhutan Literature Festival called Mountain Echoes, which ran for all of 10 years, and which created a place for discourse for stories around the mountains. That in turn led to all my learnings about the Himalayan trilogy and about my travel books. So I will tell you about the Himalayan trilogy after this, and first let me take you to some of the travel books. The first travel book I've ever done is this anthology. It's called Traveling In, Traveling Out. And it was a challenge for me because I'm really an armchair traveler. Though I do travel a lot when I go to festivals around the world, when the world still was a place to travel around. And the people I met, the sessions I curated, all led to the stories inside this. The premise of this book, this travel book, is that the days of the Western conquistador travel writer who tells the people back home what it's all about, that is over. Every place is accessible to us on Google and through Skype and through the ways I'm telling this story to you. But the inner stories of a place are local. And the stories in this book are personal, they are local, they are anecdotal. And so as I have said, as a disclaimer, this is not a travel book in the conventional sense. There are few voyages of discovery to be made in our times. We are all traveling all the time. As our small blue planet continues its trajectory around the sun, migratory birds use solar and stellar cues to intuit the magnetic field of the spinning earth and so on. So this was the first travel anthology I did, and it had a stellar cast of contributors from around the world. So from this larger perspective of stories from many places, including a Pakistani in Amsterdam, including Urzushi Butalia going to Pakistan, including the Northeast, including so many forgotten stories and ways of looking, I moved on to another anthology. And this was called, as you can see, it's called The Himalayan Arc, Journeys East of Southeast. And this again came from the journeys I had done as a festival director. I had directed a beautiful festival in Nepal many years ago called the Kathmandu Jatra. And I have, as mentioned earlier, done 10 years of Mountain Echoes in Bhutan. Between these, I got a sense of the sweep of the Himalayas and the identity across the mountains, which transcended political borders. So here this book looks at the geography, the history, the shadow of Tibet, from Nepal all the way to the to Myanmar almost, to the tail end of the Himalayas as they peter out. So again, a book of learnings, a collaborative book, where I learned so much from all the wonderful people I encountered during festivals and in my readings. So here we go back to this very important book in my life, Mountain Echoes, because from Mountain Echoes, I got the research material for the last of my Himalayan trilogy, which was Things to Leave Behind. And everybody has favorite books, books they love, characters they love. And this book is my tribute to my hometown Nainital, to my home place Kumaon, and to the stories I grew up listening to and which were reiterated in Mountain Echoes. So a lot of people ask me, where did you get this research? Because it really has a tremendous amount of research behind it. And I said I was one of the few people who knew these things firsthand, had listened to these stories. And in fact, my great-grandfather, one of my famous great-grandfathers, B.D. Pandey, had written what was a definitive history of Kumaon. And I used that. And I used something called the Himalayan Gazetteer, which were the records of administrators from the days of the Raj, as they recorded, conscientiously recorded, every aspect of life across the Himalayas. So the third in my Himalayan Connect was another book which is not here, which was an anthology called Simply the Himalaya, with Ruskin Bond. I co-edited it with a very illustrious writer who I absolutely adore. And so these Himalayan books have all fed off each other. They've given me knowledge, information, learning, insights, which flow seamlessly from one of them to the other. And now, to return to the beginning and to the end, we began with my first novel, Paro, which I wrote when I was 26. I'm 64 now, and I have done 18 books, and I've done one more just this month, which is coming out in June, which is a biography of Michael Madhusudan Dutt. It's a play, a biographical play, with my long-term collaborator, Dr. Manushri Lal, with whom I've done so many books. So 18 plus 1 is 19, and I'm now the proud author of 19 books. Let me take you to my last book, which was the Jaipur Journals. And this, again, was a tribute to what is called the greatest literary space on earth. It's a very, very funny book, but it's also a tragic book about writers. And here I have been able to bring together my life as a festival director and my life as a writer. And I've recorded the heartbreak, the pain, and also the epiphanies of being a writer. I've written two books for children, including this one, which is about time travel, and the Mahabharata for young readers. So all these books, I won't list them all and bore you, but what I want to emphasize for anybody who's listening in is that it's important to listen into everything, take in everything. We writers are cannibals. Everything is material for us, including our own stories, our own pain, our own hurts, our own learnings. And as E.M. Forster famously said, the mantra is only connect. Connect the dots, connect the stories, enter them, and you have infinite research available, you have infinite material available, if only you have the eyes, the ears, the heart, the stomach to enter every narrative without prejudice and without fear. Thank you.